Excellent. So, good morning, everybody. It is a real pleasure to meet my friends from Indonesia, and I so wish I could be in person with you, but hopefully it will be for next year. So, the next 25 minutes, what I would like to do is to present you a presentation that entitled Nanocellulose Here, There, Everywhere. So, basically, this conference is about the part of the conference is about the refining, the biorefining of the lignocellulosic, the biomass, into valuable product. And a good option of that is to upgrade the three polymers, namely the lignin, that is a bigger source of polyphenol, or the hemicellulose. But while these are two excellent options, that would be a story for another day. And what I would like to do today is rather to concentrate to look at what we can do with the cellulose, and in particular with the nanocellulose. So a few months ago, we had a team of Professor Lee and co-authors that published a very interesting article in Nature, where they really give the philosophy. So out of all the type of biomass, the lignocellulosic, we can really decompose the wood into cellulose fibers, into microfibril bundle, microfibril elemental fibers, and even the elemental chain. And as you go down in terms of the structure, as you go to a more defined and nano structure, there's a lot of new properties that are discovered and can be developed. And that's what I would like to discuss with you today. So today, what I would like to do is to discuss, hopefully, four examples. If I'm too slow, it would be three. So basically, the first one, I'm going to spend some time on the biomedical application. I'm going to present you, and we'll focus not on the diagnostic we work on, but rather on the hydrogel. And I'll give you two examples. The first one is a diagnostic to measure your blood group. The second will be how to grow organoids. Then we'll switch completely to the opposite, and we'll go a little bit in the field of Professor Manu Wong that presented us so nicely before. And we discuss superabsorbent to capture the water in soil. Australia is the driest continent, and we really need a bit of help, and I'll show you what we've investigated. The third example will be on superabsorbent, but more for personal care and packaging application. And if I have a bit of time, I will go beyond and show you a bit of what we can do in photonics, etc., with films. So basically, to show you what is our lab, this is our little institute. We're part of the biggest university of Australia, and these are basically our lab. You see, there's not too much equipment in pulp and paper. Everything is more into materials and characterization. And I do not work by myself. The strength of our institute is we work with professors from all the department and the faculty to really get a good brainstorming. So these are my co-authors, these are my co-workers, and I'm really grateful to work with these people. So let's start with the first example, and I will present you the work of basically of Rodrigo Curvelo, that finished recently his PhD. And basically, I will present the first example on nanocellulose for biomedical application. So what are we trying to do? So basically, out of the wood, we can pulp, and then we can have a eucalyptus or acacia pulp, very nice little bleach pulp. And we can take this pulp, we can refine it further to get microfibril bundle. And then we can start to do a few interesting things. So we can make nanofibers using the Tempo process that was invented a few years ago by Professor Isogai from the University of Tokyo. So basically, we're going to treat with Tempo. And what I do is I put a carboxyl group on the C6 of the carbonic C6. And basically, what it enables is to disrupt the hydrogen bond. So when I apply some mechanical shear, I'm able to separate the fibers into nanofibers, into the constitutive fibers. And that's what we've done. So you produce a very nice cellulose gel. And here, this one is basically between 0.1 and 0.3% of nanocellulose. So it's 99.9 to 99.7% water. And you see, it is really a gel, and it's biodegradable, recyclable, biocompatible. And I will show you what we can do with that. So basically, here, what we do is we have some water, basically some structured water. And let's look at that. So we investigate the biomedical application you can have, and we share there's five. Of these five, we work with three. And today, I would like to focus on two examples. on basically diagnostic by separation, and I'll show you an example of blood typing. And the second on how to grow 3D cells, and we're going to grow some organoids together in a few minutes. So I start with my bleach pump, and you have some similar very nice pump in Indonesia. To that, I can do a tempo process. So I'm going to carboxylate the pump. And if I take this carboxylate pump and I use it in an homogenizer, I apply shear. So basically what I have is a pipe that goes in a valve. It produces tremendous amount of shear at very high pressure. What I will do is basically I will shear, I will separate my individual fibers into nanocellulose. So that's what we're doing. And you produce a gel. Very simple. Good. So here I discuss the tempo process that just react with the C6. But if I want to have more carboxyl group, if I want to disrupt the hydrogen bond more, I can combine the tempo with other treatment and develop a few chemistry, and you can combine that in one pot with the sodium periodate that will attack the C2 and C3. So therefore, we can have much more carboxylic group. And the more carboxylic group, the easier it is to shear, the more you have individual fibers, the clearer is the gel, and the lower is the modulus. So you really change the properties of the gel. And this is how we control some of the properties for the application actually in biomedical, in agriculture, and in personal care with super adsorbent. So let's proceed. The first example is in blood typing. So if some of you had a blood test this morning, and if you ask your doctor to determine what is your group, this is basically the technique that they use. We use basically a gel card. So this is a little column that is filled up with the little beads, micro beads of a gel, polyacrylamide gel, in which we put a little antibody. So we put the A or the B and so on, and you put the blood. And if your blood is compatible with the antibody that is tested, it forms a little chunk, so it's a little aggregate. And when you centrifuge the test, basically you have a little chunk, it stays at the bottom. And if it's not compatible with the antibody test, it will go at the bottom, and therefore you have the bar at the bottom. So if you have a bar at the top, that means it is the antigen antibody that you test. And if it is at the bottom, it is not. It's a positive negative. Very simple, and pretty much all the blood is tested like that. However, there's a problem. The problem is there's a lack of sensitivity, and you see it is the signal is not always the clearest. And when we want to use image analysis to automate, it can be an issue. And also the cartridge, we can make them in PLA, but the gel are not biodegradable. So we wanted to see, can we do something with nanocellulose? Can we do something a little bit more friendly and more performant? So what Rodrigo did, basically, he applied, he developed the nanocellulose gel and filled up this little tube, and we did the same thing. So this is a commercial test, and this is with the cellulose gel. And what you notice is the bar is much crisper than with the commercial, and the same for the positive, and it is very clear. Very clear, that means I can use optical system to really analyze the cell directly in the gel, and this is here what we've been doing. So that's the first application. But where we're really excited and I wanted to share with you is the ability to grow organoids. I don't know, some of you must have been familiar with organoids, but organoids are mini organ. So basically, this is a fairly recent discovery. It is the ability to take some cell and to grow into a mini organ that has the same functionality and the same behavior. So today, I will just focus on one type of organs, basically the organoids made from the intestine. So how do you get that? That means we're going to take a little culture of the intestine. We're going to have a crease. That means we have the form convolution. We're going to put in a culture system, and we're going to grow it in over the next something typically it's 4 to 7 days. And what will end up is a little organoid. It's a little organ that is semicircular, and that has the same functionality, and it is used to screen drugs and as a model. So how it is used? It is very exciting because if I have a cancer, what we would do is to take a sample of my tumor and a sample of the good tissue. We're going to grow the organelles on which we can try the different drugs to have a drug that is very selective to the cancer and that will not kill me. So it really opens a lot of new possibilities in medicine. So why are we interested by that? Because there's a very nice commercial product that is called Matrigel. But Matrigel has a few problems. Basically, it is made from the sarcoma cell of mouse. That means to take a mouse, you inflict them a tumor, you let the tumor grow in the mouse, and then you kill the mouse to get the tumor to get the gel. That is how it's done. So there's a bit of problem of that. That means you need a lot of mouse to do a 10 milliliters dose. And so that means you have a lot of variability. You don't quite know what are the molecule. And it is expensive. You're going to pay between $600 and $1,000 Australian dollars per little dose that you need for your treatment. So it's out of reach for most of the people. So here, what we wanted to do, can we replace that with nanocellulose gel that would cost a few cents? And is it possible to do? So we had absolutely no idea. So we started this journey, and basically the approach is the same. We started from wood, and we would like to produce a gel under which we can functionalize, so we can put some peptide to improve the adhesion and the biocompatibility. We're going to grow, and we're going to see the viability of our organoids. So our approach initially was to mimic the gold standard that was the Matrigel. That means we try to get the same mechanical properties. And how we do that? We cross-link. We can control the cross-linking density. So that's the first variable. We wanted to get the same chemical properties. That means we can have the same additive in the gel as in the Matrigel. And also the biological properties. So we can graft some peptide on the nanocellulose in order to favor the adhesion of the organoids and the cell in the growth. So that was the original approach. And I show you some of the results. I go directly with the conclusion. We succeeded. So here, what I show you is the organoids. So I show you the organoids on the left-hand side after the day two and the day four. And what I compare is the original nanocellulose gel, the gel with basic glycerin. So we put a protein to control the ionic strength. And then a gel in which we functionalize, we put a little peptide and we graft on the nanocellulose to compartmentalize, and you compare with natural gel. And what I do is very simple. We use two types of dye. We use a dye that is green that shows the live part of the organoids. So if it's green, that means it's alive. And another one that is red that shows when the tissue is dead. So when it's red, it's dead. And we do that for day two and four. So what we see is if you take the nanocellulose gel as is, you take the organoids, you have nothing. So it's a lot of red. If you put a bit of your adjust the ionic strength to the same level as the Matrigel, the day two, it's okay. You have a live organoids, but it doesn't stay alive very long. It doesn't really progress or multiply. Sorry. So if you go with the RGD, that means peptide functionalize, we're able to get basically the organoids alive, and it stays alive after 4 days. So basically, we succeeded, and we can use the nanocellulose gel. Great. We're very encouraged, and so hurry, hurry. Let's continue. But life is always a little bit more complex because basically what we have with these organoids, we do transfer. That's what we call passage. That means the system, the organic system is spoiled after a little bit of time, and you need to passage, you need to retransfer the organoids. So you take the organoids, you centrifuge to separate them from the gel, you put them in a new gel, and you grow them again. So that's what is done. But if you go with the Matrigel, the passage goes very well. So here, what I show you is the density of organoids. So this is what I plot, the density per unit area. So the Matrigel is the black, it's excellent after first passage and second. But if you go with the calcium functionalized, and I show you, the first passage is not too bad, but the second is not too good. And you say, oh, what's going on? So we do the DNA analysis of the organoids. And basically, what we analyze is a few genes. And what we notice is we notice a gene that is attenuated by the calcium. So basically, the calcium affects the gene, which turns down the growth of the organoids. So calcium is a bit of a killer. So we say, how can we cross-link easily without calcium? So therefore, we decided to try with magnesium. And this is what we've done. And magnesium works fairly well. So we really improved the problem. Good, but like I told you, the way we manipulate the organoids, typically we centrifuge, we need to do a passage, we need to change the media. And we want a system where we can control the gelification. So we want a gel at body temperature when you grow the organoids, and you would like to gel, you would like the system to turn liquid at low temperature, such as you can centrifuge and separate. So we need something that is thermosensitive. And that's why we investigate the modification of a nanocellulose. So what we do is take the nanocellulose and we're going to graft some NIPAM. NIPAM is a well-known thermosensitive polymer. So we graft that over the fibers, and this is below 35. It is a liquid and it is clear. And if you heat above 35, it turns into a gel. And you can measure that with the absorbance. And very nicely, the transition of liquid to gel is pretty much at the body temperature. So again, we can go, and basically what this research show is there's very strong results, and we have a very we're convinced that we can completely replace the animal-based matrix gel by nanocellulose gel for biomedical application. So that was my first example. Now let's go to another part. So health is critical, but food is as important. And as the population grow, it's important to be able to feed everybody without destroying the environment. And this is basically the task of Melanie Woods, that is a PhD on investigating nanocellulose superadsorbent for agriculture. And basically, why do we need superadsorbent? Is in Australia, it's very dry. So what we would like is to keep the water in the soil, so such as we have a drop, we can go through, and it helps to carry and to keep the nutrient. We can keep it to cook the seed, etc. So there's a lot of commercial products, and most of them are petrochemical based, so they're made out of acrylamide or polyacrylamide. So they work very nicely, but they do not degrade in soil. So that means they just accumulate, and we have a sustainability issue. So what we wanted to do is to investigate, can we do a nice cellulose gel that will retain water and be able to help us with our agriculture? So that's the hypothesis that we had. So the process to make the gel is the same as what I show you for the biomedical. You take the wood and you do a nice pulp, and you have a lot of meal that you beautiful quality pulp in Indonesia. So we take this pulp, we're going to refine it a bit, do a tempo treatment, and we fiberize, and again the same, we have a gel. But here, you know, the counter-ions with the tempo is sodium, and sodium, it's basically the salt. It's not good for the soil. We wanted the ability to change the salt from sodium to other type of iron and to see how they affect. So we modify the procedure. We can do an acid wash and then do ion exchange in the solution to control the cation under which is our gel. And then we take the gel and we dry it. We develop all kind of process. We can spray dry, oven dry, freeze dry. And I'm going to show you a few examples of a nanocellulose form, a nanocellulose superadsorbent that we characterize. And then we grow plant with this cellulose. So that's what we're doing. So we can look at the rheology, and depending of the what we see is the gel is shear thinning. That means the more shear, the more the more fluid it is, so it's very convenient. And for the mono iron for the mono, yes, it's the viscosity is higher than for the divalent iron, and this is explained by the change of a charge. That means the monovalent iron, so that means the sodium and potassium have a very high zeta potential, so the system is highly stabilized. While you go for the divalent system, the charge is a little bit lower. And as you change the counter ions of the form, you see this is the SEM of the form. It really changes the structure for something like a filament. And you see that the most open structure is achieved with the ammonia. And if you go with the divalent iron, basically from type of sheet, so it's not as porous as with the ions. And you can measure the pore size distribution. And what we see is that each ion has a different pore size distribution, pore diameter, and so on. So now we can really quantify the porosity. And out of this porosity, after that, we can put the superadsorbent into water and see what is the swelling. And what we notice is the gel under the monovalent ion swell more than under the divalent. So we understand a little bit the structure swelling ability. So now with this understanding, let's grow plant. And here I show the example of spinach. We grew up bok choy, but this is spinach for today. So what we do is we put the seed, we let it grow, and we water to a same moisture content. We did test at 30, 50, 70%. We grew up to 6 weeks. We do five replicates for each. And here you see, you go on the left, the big plant, you say, hooray, of course, it's exactly the same pole, hooray, nanocellulose work. No, this is not the case. This is the commercial one. Nanocellulose high dose is here. It's the worst. Why? What's going on? So that's what we're going to investigate. So if you go with the control, without nothing, this is what we have. If we add fertilizer, it's a bit better. If we had a bit of nanocellulose, it's pretty much the same, but not quite as good as the petrochemical superabsorbent. So we really wanted to investigate more, and that's what we did. So at first, we took, at the end, we just collected the biomass, and we see how much biomass we have. And what we notice is the control, and the control is the lowest. The control of fertilizer and low dose of nanocellulose are a little bit better, but and similar. If you put a lot of nanocellulose, 1%, which is a lot, is not very good, the same as control. And here is a commercial. The commercial, we really see all the biomass is much higher. So why? What's going on? Because we saw that the absorption ability of water is as good as the commercial superabsorbent, but nanocellulose that is natural, biodegradable, doesn't work as well. So then what we decided to do is to look at the respiration of the soil. That means you grow the plant and we will separate the plant. We just look at the CO2 emission of the soil and we measure after as a function of time. And this is what we found. And that's really interesting. So the more CO2 you have, that means the more bugs you have in the soil, the more you have activity in the roots. So that's what it tells. So if you look at the control and with the fertilizer, you have a moderate activity. And it's the same as the superabsorbent. So what it means is the commercial superabsorbent does not degrade in the soil. And that's exactly what the results show. However, if you put the nanocellulose, wow, a little bit, it degrades quite a lot. There's a lot of activity. And 1%, oof, it's a huge party. And you have the bugs that are dancing all over. And basically, we should give them a sugar headache. We intoxicate our bugs with too much sugar. That means we have in the soil, we have the nanocellulose that is degraded by the enzyme into glucose. The glucose degrade, and we intoxicate the flora with the sugar. So we need to slow down the degradation. And that's what we really found. And it really affects also with the cycle of the nitrogen. That means if you have a lot of carbon, such as nanocellulose, we have more growth of microorganisms that compete with the plant. That means all the energy is in the root and there's not enough for the plants. So that is the problem. So the key is to slow down the degradation to capture the water, but we don't want the cellulose to degrade that fast. So we started very, I would say, naively. We say nanocellulose superabsorbent would be fantastic with the water cycle. Yes, it is. But we ignore the effect of the carbon cycle and the nitrogen. And now we're trying to optimize not one cycle, but the three cycles. And that's a bit what we saw with the presentation of Professor Manurung just before. And what we're trying to do now is to slow down the crosslinking. We use lignin, we chemically modify the nanocellulose chair to control the biodegradation while retaining the superabsorbent ability. That was my second example. Now let's go a little bit faster. We're going to present the superabsorbent, nanocellulose superabsorbent for packaging and personal care. And I will introduce you the work of Lila that just finished her PhD a few days ago. And basically, again, we will make nanocellulose foam out of the wood. And the two applications we're interested in is basically in packaging. We want to do a little absorbent for meat or fruit or veggies that absorb the liquid for better presentation and to keep it longer. And also for the diaper, we work with diagnostic, but that will be a story for another day. So what we did, we have a little apparatus. First, we wanted to look what is the effect of the performance, how fast, what is the kinetic of absorption. And we investigate the effect of surface charge, that means the level of a carboxylic group. And what we have is we have a little superabsorbent overbalance, and we measure the weight change as function of time. And we have a camera. We use a dye, and we see how fast goes the water inside. And what we do is as function of time. So here I see the weight, and this is from a high
Excuse
start
me,
at
Professor Gill.
Yes, few more.
It's very nice, but due to time constraint, could you speed up your presentation, Professor?
Absolutely. Let's go directly
okay, thank you.
To the end. So that's the structure. We will not go beyond, and we will conclude. And I would like to conclude, this is a team. We work really with industry. And during the COVID, we were closed. And in 2 months that were closed, Power Priad Institute was remain open, and we had two tasks. In 2 months, we had a team that developed a diagnostic to analyze COVID. And we did that with the same mechanism, the same system as the blood system that I show you for COVID. And the second, we had no non-woven, so coming in Australia. So in 2 months, we work with our industrial partner and we make a laminated paper medical gown that is COVID resistant. And this is the team, and you see we're all modern. So with that, I would stop, and I would like again to thank the opportunity to the committee to present and to see you. It's a real pleasure to be with you in Indonesia. Thank you.